Elaine Rush from New Zealand, so I can't speak for Australia. But in New Zealand, the intake of empty calories from alcohol is always amazes me how much it is increasing, and particularly the availability of alcohol. So similar to sugar, I think that's something we should be looking at as well for many reasons.
I definitely agree. In our country, people haven't thought too much about alcohol as a contributor to the obesity problem, but it'd be interesting to model the extent to which that's the case, and it sounds like in other countries it might be even a more profound impact.
20% of calories of young men can be from beer. That's an enormous amount.
Sure is.
Yeah. And sure. I'm sure it does other damage to the liver as well. So.
Yes, and I've read some things by the people that have worked on alcohol policy, and they say the same things that we're talking about. Access and cost and marketing become the primary drivers of the high alcohol intake, and that those are the things government can get in and regulate.
Yes, we have been talking to our government about your sugar tax and using your papers as an example, not with much success yet, but we'll keep on, and thank you very much.
Okay.
Well, if I can just make a comment here, that we've had lots of discussion on that here in Australia, and particularly in relation to Indigenous communities, and the extraordinarily ready availability of cheap alcohol in places like Darwin and Alice Springs, and the opposition, so it raised the whole idea about a volumetric tax that is related to alcohol content, and there's a very good argument for that, and I'm sure Mike Dorff has much more to say about that than I. But in the labelling logic, you know, very good food labelling report that was released in Australia earlier, that they actually, and I think the government has said it will accept putting calories onto bottles. Now, it hasn't said that? No? Okay, sorry. I thought that was one of the things they were willing to look at then. But, yep. But I think that's one of the things we could... I think that's one of the low-hanging fruit myself. I actually think it's something that you could actually raise quite a lot of quite a head of steam on. But now, hands were going up everywhere. So we'll go to Jane first. And
Jane Martin, Obesity Policy Coalition. Kelly, I'm really interested in that idea of conflicts of interest, and I think it's something that a lot of institutions face. Have you got any advice around dealing with that sort of issue? Because I think that in some areas we potentially could work with industry, but other areas I don't think that's possible.
Well, so the question comes up a lot about our own relationship with industry. We have delegations from industry come and visit us, and I'll go talk to them as well, but the condition is that no money changes hands. So I've gone and talked to their trade associations and things, but I'll pay my own way and not accept a dime of their money, and that seems okay. I don't mind talking to the extent it's fruitful, but I don't want money to change hands, and that's what creates a conflict of interest. Now, I don't know what exists in this country, but in our country, the response to conflicts of interest is disclosure. So when people write articles in professional journals or give talks at meetings, they may have to disclose whether they're getting money from industry. Well, that's a bizarre approach, because if you're making people disclose it, there's some recognition that there's something wrong. But then why do you let them do it in the first place? So it's like I can come up and kick you in your leg, but it's okay if I tell you that I did it. So there's a twisted logic to it that way. But also, there's been some research in the U.S. about the impact of disclosure. And what you find is that an audience who's heard some sort of disclosure will discount what the speaker is saying, but to a very small extent. But the speaker, having made the disclosure, feels like they can be even stronger in their message, and that makes it worse rather than better. So disclosure, I think, is a complete sham. So our universities aren't capable of policing this, at least in our country, because our universities get money from industry. Our professional organizations can't do it because they get money from industry, and the leaders in the field can't because they're cashing in a big way. So to me, the change agent is the press. and the press is hungry for investigative information like this. Who's taking money from who, and then what kind of science do they do? And an investigative reporter can really go to town on this. So there have been some very celebrated cases in the U.S. of scientists who have been exposed for taking money from industry and then completely providing data that the industry wants. And they've been humiliated, embarrassed, lost positions in professional societies, and it's people are starting to at least think twice now about taking money.
Thanks, Kelly. That was great. It's Karen Campbell here from Deakin University. I just wanted to raise the issue, I guess, of salt, both from the point of view of a potential link to soft drink consumption and obviously exploitation, I would suggest, by food industry, but also the incredible public health success capacity, as has been demonstrated in the UK with legislative changes that have resulted in I think, a 1% reduction in per capita consumption of sodium. One of our PhD students at Deakin, who's just finishing off and has just submitted a paper looking at the Australian National Nutrition Survey data with children, has shown that soft drink consumption and sodium consumption are very nicely, tightly linked.
Oh, really?
With perhaps more tenuous associations with rates of overweight and obesity.
Okay, thanks for bringing that up. In our country, people haven't talked about that link too much, and so the obesity people working on policy haven't talked much about sodium reduction. But to the extent it's linked with soft drink consumption, which makes sense, then it could be a very potentially powerful public health intervention, not to mention all the other the non-obesity related benefits that you get from that. Right. That's one example, at least in the UK, as you mentioned, where industry has shown that it can kind of work in concert and that they've gradually titrated down the amount of salt in their products. And if that could be done with sugar and fat, terrific. That would be a good way to do it. Thank you for bringing that up.
Hi. Thank you for your talk. I'm Mark Daniel from the Sansom Institute, University of South Australia. Firstly, I'd probably question the idea that education is the default position, because having taught public health in Chapel Hill, we're taught that regulatory, organizational, and policy level action is what defines health promotion as distinct from health education per se. And there are many examples of health promotion in that vein. So I wondered if you could comment on the link between what you'd call the optimal defaults, which pertains then to legislation, regulatory action, and the motivational strategies that you did raise briefly in one of the slides, because I wasn't sure of the link that may exist between those motivational strategies and those optimal defaults, or which you might envision arising. Second is really whether you think a focus on food is the way to go. We know that the disadvantaged in society bear the burden of whatever cause of morbidity and mortality is going at the moment. Right. So is a focus on the food industry really the way to go when we have so much social inequality, which drives that kind of differential in morbidity and mortality?
Okay, boy, those are terrific questions. The first one about the defaults. At least in our country, the public health community and the public health model doesn't always prevail as the main way we approach some of these problems. In some cases it does, but far too seldom it occurs. And so the country, when you talk to legislators, do they automatically think prevention? Never. Do they give a lot of money for prevention versus traditional medical treatment? Never. And so the country, our leaders are defaulting to more traditional medical models of things and not enough to public health. But when they do think public health, then of course you hit home runs and you know then you get a lot done. The second question is, why are we going after the food industry as opposed to other things? There's so many drivers of the obesity problem. And if you ask me, if I could accomplish everything I talked about today, what would happen to the rates of obesity? Maybe they would level off. Maybe. Maybe there would be a slight downward trend. You're going to have to do a lot of things at the same time, including addressing inequalities, including addressing the physical activity part of the equation. There's so many things going on that we can't just focus on taxes or the food industry or marketing or things like that. But the question is, where are good places to start? Where can you get some winnable victories? And we think that these are possibilities, especially based on the tobacco experience. Some people say that the tobacco experience isn't so relevant here. I don't agree with that at all. I think it's tremendously relevant. And, I mean, there are 40 years of hard-won victories in the people that fought those fights. And we need to learn from them. And we need to compress this history, not into 40 years, but maybe 4 or 5 years, by not making some of the mistakes that got made inadvertently and by learning from the victories. And so the tobacco victories, some of it was education, but so much more of it was just straight old public policy and laws that I think we need to go the same way. But that's just my bias. Thank you for the questions.
Hi, Tim Gill from Sydney University. Kelly opened this presentation by saying that to get action on obesity, we have to win the moral argument rather than the scientific argument. And I'm not so sure that we've done so well at that in Australia, and I think most of us come from that scientific base. So, you know, what is it that we actually have to do to actually, you know, drive that moral imperative rather than, you know, focusing on the science?
I'm not so sure I know, because I've only recently begun thinking about this, but I've had a dream that if somebody gave me more money, I would create a rapid response framing research center so that we could address some of these questions empirically, which you can now do very fast with internet surveys and things like that. In a week, you can get information about how to best frame a message. And I would love to have this center at the ready so that if we get a call from a senator in one of our states who says, I want to do a tax or I want to go after marketing or something, the center could leap into action, could do some of these studies about the best way to frame the messages, and then we could get that information out to all of us so that we're acting more on a script. And as you and I talked about before, the industry is incredibly good at staying on script. If I hear what the industry says here, it's word for word what they're saying in the United States. But we're all over the place, you know, because we're NGOs, we're public health people, we're government people, and we're not on a script, partly because we don't know what the right script is, and it would be great to have some empirical answers to those questions. But otherwise, we just have to go on intuition. And you saw what my intuition is, but it might be completely wrong.
Thanks very much for your presentation. So I'm Leslie King, also from Sydney University. And I guess my question is also about the script, if you like, for public health advocacy and advocacy tactics. And I guess two examples come to mind from your presentation, so I'm interested in just your advice to us, if you like. So it's really about the debate about the low-hanging fruit, incrementalism versus going for the goals that we really have. And the two examples where I guess this plays out that I'm sort of come to mind from what you've presented in my own research. Well, one, first of all, on the soft drink tax. So you've probably already understood that in Australia, the T words, there's an allergy to that currently, and that's probably going to go for a few more years yet. So tactically, one would think that maybe now's not the time to advocate for that or only with a long-term goal. So tactically, would you suggest that? And for example, should we be arguing the case for, say, volumetric pricing of soft drinks as a sort of interim, you know, let's do something, let's do what we can, while we wait for a kind of cultural change that might allow us to discuss tax rationally again? I guess food marketing, and I've done a lot of work in food marketing, including the study, I think, that was behind the press release about examining the impact of the industry self-regulatory codes. And there, I think, in the papers we write or the advocacy we do, a goal would be typically to, in fact, have government statutory regulation governing limiting food advertising. Mm-hmm. But government's a bit allergic to that as well. And so there are many intermediate goals one could go for. One of them that comes to mind, which, in fact, would be a national, independent, transparent monitoring system for starters, because there is no such thing. So at the moment, what wins the day is industry lobbying based on anecdotal reports done by themselves about themselves. So what I'm interested in then is your advice about the tactics of incrementalism versus going for the, right, the goals that we think are going to be more effective.
Okay. I'm in some ways reluctant to answer, but I will. But just please know that this is totally my intuition and nothing more. In 1994, I wrote an editorial piece for the New York Times calling for food taxes, and I got blistered from that. I got hate mail. I got death threats. There's a conservative political commentator in our country, Rush Limbaugh, that went after me time and again on his program. The Wall Street Journal wrote an editorial criticizing the idea. It was one thing after another. So I thought, well, there are lots of other things we could work on. Let me stop talking about the tax. And what I found is that there was a lot less attention paid to what we were talking about when I dropped that out, so I put it right back in. And it's become a lightning rod, in a way, for the whole issue, which has been great. And my intuition tells me that it's a very good thing to keep it in because it makes other things seem less extreme. And now we're to the point, you know, where we're even considering the tax. The most radical thing that's been proposed is now in routine consideration in countries and in cities and states in the U.S. So I think one way to make things seem more normative is to keep talking about them, even though they may not be politically feasible at a given point. And so that's why we kept in that discussion of the taxes. And I think it's led to some pretty good outcomes as we've gone along. The other thing that I might say is that there will be a tipping point, hopefully. There has been in the U.S., where legislators are now talking a lot about it, the obesity problem. Not just a few, but a lot are talking about it. And they need to have ideas about what to do. They need a blueprint for what to do. And this tipping point happened fast. And if we're unprepared for that tipping point as a public health community, we're not going to be able to provide them specific advice on what to do. And so that means going even beyond a concept like a tax or marketing restrictions, but in the specific legislative language in some cases. Get public health lawyers to work out what the legal authority is for various parts of government on marketing, for example, and be prepared to address those questions quickly when they come up, because hopefully there will be such a tipping point. And then if you're here with a thoughtful, reasoned, science-based idea about how to proceed, then we'll be more helpful to our legislators. But it's also true the low-hanging fruit is a good idea because you want some winnable victories. In our case, it was nutrition in the schools was the low-hanging fruit. And most everybody agreed it was terrible what was happening in the schools, and a lot of changes have been made. And each time they do, the local press covers it, the national press covers it, and then you get a lot of attention to the obesity issue. And then that helps pave the way for other things that might be done.
This is fantastic. Conversation that we're having here. I'm just time for two more questions and answers from Ian Olver and Mike Daub, and then we'll take a break. But you'll have plenty of time after that to have more discussion.
Sorry, Ian Olver from Cancer Council Australia. I just want to ask a question about evidence-based advocacy, I guess. I mean, from the tobacco experience, the industry says you haven't got the evidence for a particular public health measure, and opposition politicians may say that. So if we take something like food labelling, you know, what are reasonable endpoints that would be persuasive there? Because there's a lot of literature where they're, you know, scrubbing them off if they haven't caused behavioural change in 6 weeks. So do we have to be a little bit more focused on what the endpoints are that we'll measure?
That's such a good question, because you hate to go to a lot of trouble to get some policy enacted that, in fact, doesn't change behaviour, not only because you've wasted the political capital, but because then it's less likely you're going to get other things done in the future. And the menu labeling was a great example of that. The United States, a lot of groups, including ours, pushed very hard for menu labeling, and now the studies have started to come out on it, and they're mixed. Some studies suggest it has a good impact, and other studies suggesting it doesn't have any impact. And in looking back on it, I'm thinking that's okay as an outcome, and we've got to prepare our legislators for those kind of mixed findings. And so the importance of the menu labeling, I think, wasn't its impact on public health so much, but that it primed the pump and it got people ready to do these sort of legislative things that may turn into more powerful interventions. Plus, it may have a good impact itself. But you have to be prepared to ride out that storm of what happens when you don't have convincing data, which is almost completely predictable with any of these sort of things. The other thing is sometimes our fellow scientists can be really a pain in the neck on these things, especially the ones who are getting money from industry, because they will dress up their opposition to this on by taking the scientific high ground. There aren't randomized trials to show that taxes work. Well, of course, there are no taxes, so how can you do it? And so then I go back and I evoke the tobacco example by saying that with tobacco taxes, the economists had modeled what they thought would happen with the impact of taxes, but they didn't really know until the taxes actually occurred, and then you could test them, and in some cases they had a greater impact than was expected. And so with things like taxes on sugared beverages, the same thing. We can guess, and our economists can create models, but we don't really know until we do them. And I'll usually say that if your standard is completely tight, controlled, randomized trials, before you move ahead with a public health intervention, we'd have no seatbelt laws, we'd have no airbags in cars, we'd have no tobacco taxes, we wouldn't have fluoride in the water. You could have a very long immunization of children. You wouldn't have any of these things if that's what you required before you did the policy. So smart policy is informed as well as it might be by science, and then testing it carefully and being prepared to move on to something else if it doesn't work seems to be the best approach.
Just very briefly, it's a fabulous presentation. As one who's been involved in tobacco for 40 years, I couldn't agree with you more. Of course, there are obvious differences, but the similarities are huge. Just a couple of, one observation in particular is that something that we speak about in tobacco is the scream test. The louder the industry scream, the more you know it's going to have an impact. Mm-hmm. And I think in this area, what you've been demonstrating, your lobbying slide and so on, is that whatever else we're looking to as evidence, we should be looking to the scream test, and wherever they're screaming, then we push as hard as we can.
You know, that's a terrific point, and I agree with that. And one of the places where I think it might be particularly relevant here is that a lot of the focus on obesity, at least in our country, has been on getting good food into the system. So trying to get healthy foods to the poor would be an example. Farmers markets to poor neighborhoods, things like that. But the inference there, but it never gets articulated, is that if you push good food into the system, the bad food is going to leave the other end somehow. And research doesn't really support that very much. And it could be that you're just adding more calories in, healthy calories, but calories nonetheless. And so is it a better approach to focus on more of the good food versus less of the bad food? You can see what we've done is clearly to try to get rid of the bad food and hope that good food will take its place. There's more support from that than the reverse. But the scream test applies there. The industry doesn't scream about the good food approaches. They do about trying to try to get people to eat less of anything. That's a very good point.
So I think you'll all agree this has been an absolutely superb presentation. It's it really is. We're so incredibly privileged to have had Kelly Brownell here with us today, and he's here for the rest of the afternoon. So if you will join me in thanking him.